Hey guys, this is Double D, one of the hosts of the After School Special Podcast. We're still hard at work, working on season two, but we decided, hey, let's not leave them hanging. We're going to release a lost episode that didn't make season one. So we hope you guys enjoy.
I'm talking to myself. Do you hear me? Don's gotta go upstairs because people are stomping on the floor. I'm gonna talk some more because I have mental issues.
2,000 years later.
Titty, 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 dick, a suck a dick. And a titty, tit, suck a dick. Titty, tit. Hey, Macarena.
A few inches later.
And so, I'm on the podcast by myself right now talking about memories. Memories. Hey, you know, when the boots are a-knockin', don't come a-knockin'. I think I got that wrong.
Eventually.
No, when the boots are a-rock, when the bed is a-rockin', don't come a-knockin'. Or when the car is fucking. There we go. Hey, this is a special episode of AS.
AS! Woo!
Don and I are the only ones on here. Jonathan, our head honcho, our main historian on all things nostalgia, is not here. We've been drinking. We've been bad.
Oh, yeah. When John's away,
we come and fucking play.
That just means we're prepared. That's what I think.
No, we're not.
No, not at all. There's no research.
On the phone, because we were going to do, this is a relaxed episode instead of the themes or the lists that we do. So we decided to kind of stick to memories, things that we remember, toy-wise, movie-wise. And like, this is the biggest thing with nostalgia is digging into the human mind. Why these memories exist. Why we contemplate life. And the ending, within this time frame from birth to death, we have these moments in time that are forever. Holy shit, that was really fucking good.
I know, that was good, dude.
But
my mind is blown.
Well, the thing is that we could think it's really good, and then we listen back, and it's just me like, burp.
No, that's what's going to happen. Probably need to throw this episode away, but that's okay.
No, we're going to play this, or at least like when we decide if we ever get actual listeners and it's just, you know, it's not our parents or aunts and uncles listening to it.
Whoa, wow. You think they're going to listen?
My mom will.
You have high hopes.
And my mom will, and she'll be like, you got to stop with all the swearing. That's how she talks.
Does your mom care if you cuss or like...
No, she doesn't give a shit. She swears to me. She's like, stop acting like a...
I am still not allowed to cuss in front of my mom. And, yeah.
She'll take her shoe off and, like, you know, like the little... what is it? She says Hispanic. We're European Spanish. So it's like, you know, I'm still white.
Now, you know you fucked up when your parent is cussing at you in a different language. Like,
well,
or
she's
a second language.
She's called me pendejo before, which is like fucking ass or, you know, dumb. But she doesn't take off the shoe or anything. She had a wooden spoon. That was the thing that I remember.
Damn, you used to get your ass beat with a wooden spoon?
Oh, hell yeah.
Talk about memories.
Like fucking lead pipe or something?
Did you ever have to pick out your own switch?
No.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I never had to do that.
I'm assuming, had to do that.
No,
wow.
I'm assuming that you tried to find something smaller or bigger.
Oh, yeah. That didn't work. Anybody of color, black, brown, they know that if you try to do that, you will then get a bigger beating because that'll insult the parent that's trying to whoop your ass because they know what you're trying to do. You're being manipulative. So, yeah, I learned that you at least have to get... I'm going to speak closer to the mic. You got to get a mid-size whoop-ass stick. So then they'll take it a little easier on you when they're like hacking away at your ass. But
oh, Jesus.
Man, that might have been too deep. But that didn't happen to me too often, to be fair. So I don't want to make my mom was just whooping my ass left and right.
The thing is, that's how we grew up. Like, my mom chased me with a butcher knife when I was a teenager.
Yeah, I've been chased before.
But we look back at it fondly, you know, not that there's irreparable damage there.
I'm going to add on to that, Aaron. I think, and I'm talking to this generation, what do they call them? The Gen Zs?
Gen Zs, I think, yeah.
Is it Gen Zs? Okay. I think what's missing the most out of this generation is the thinking that getting an ass whooping is bad. I think every now and then you need an ass whooping just to balance out. Like, okay.
It humbles you, man.
It does.
It humbles you.
It does. And I didn't get a lot of ass whoopings, not because I was a tough guy. I was just very artful of knowing how to get out of that. But when I did get an ass whooping, yeah, it was like, oh, okay, I'm not as tough, or I'm not as clever as I thought I was. But that's my two cents for the generation.
I used to, like I said, like one of my favorite pastimes, I would watch Casino. And I would stay home from school sometimes, and I would order lasagna and fucking ravioli from these Italian restaurants or pizza places. Mind you, like, at that time, I started getting fat.
Get in my belly!
Wait, what years are we talking? Are we talking the 10-year-old Aaron?
This is probably 10, 11, 12, 13.
Wait a minute. You're ordering lasagnas as a 10-year-old?
Oh, dude, I was making money, man. That's like, I would do chores and everything. I would expect to get like a $20 little stipend and whatnot, because I was the only one doing the yard work at my house. I had three other fucking brothers who were lazy as shit.
You shit-kicking, stinky, horse manure-smelling motherfucker, you.
Sorry, Eric, you're a fucking prick. And I love you. Call me. Anyways. So what I would do is I would order food, wait till the food got there, and then start watching Goodfellas, start watching Casino.
As a kid.
My mom had it on VHS, so I'd watch it. Like, we were still on VHSs when I was 10, 11. We didn't switch to DVDs yet. Yeah, it was just, I loved it. It was one of the fondest memories that I had, but it also made me think that, oh, I want to be like that. I'm a tough guy. And I remember the first time I acted like a tough guy at school. I got my ass handed to me, like, to the point, like, black eyes and everything. And my mom asked what happened. I'm like, I fell down the stairs. And that was it, because it's like, you get humbled. And the thing is that I became friends with that guy, like, senior year. I'm like, how fucking stupid was that? Like, I was even talking. I'm like, humbled the shit out of me. Thank you for kicking my ass. I kind of deserved it.
Wow. You know, you got your ass whooped good when you thank the person that whooped your ass. Like, oh man, thank you.
Well, I fucking needed it. It's not like a week that, because now I could take him. He didn't grow after high school.
Me either. I was like a tallish type of middle school, elementary guy, and I did not grow. I'm like I was a mid-size, and then everybody grew like 8 inches. Nice, Aaron.
Yep. You have to have that sound effect.
Anyway, so that's your memory of getting your ass whooped?
That is one of my memories. Yeah, getting my ass whooped. And the thing was that after
nostalgic.
That, humbled the shit out of me.
So to get back to memories, so Goodfellas was your memory as a kid? I thought you were going to say something more kiddie.
Dude, I love that movie. A Casino, what we were talking about earlier, Casino is like my all-time favorite Scorsese film, but on my
Casino,
top 10.
Not Goodfellas.
I like Goodfellas, but for some reason Casino hit a little more at home because I was born in Las Vegas. Like, that is my home.
Okay,
hometown.
That makes sense now.
And my mother and my grandmother, they were all around that shit. Like the Stardust, where it's based off of, like Stardust, the Horseshoe.
The Tangiers.
Yeah, Tangiers was the Stardust, like the actual Stardust with, Lefty Rosenthal was the actual person. And Tony Spilatro was the Joe Pesci character, and Lefty Rosenthal was the Robert De Niro character. And my grandma actually talked to me about it. She remembers when they found Tony Spilatro's body in a cornfield. And
was that wasn't in Vegas, was it? Was that in like...
No. No,
that was
Indiana.
In Iowa or something? Okay.
It was in Indiana.
You're going to be my sponsor?
No, Jesus.
Everybody hated Sharon Stone in that movie, but And the fact that it came out, like, what, a couple of years after Goodfellas, it didn't do as well.
95, Goodfellas came out, 1995. Goodfellas came out in 1990, so it was a five-year time span. Mm-hmm. And then, technically, his next... He didn't actually have a gangster film until, I want to say, either 2006 was The Departed, which I always forget about, and now I want to watch it. I am a huge Scorsese fan when it comes to his gangster films and other films. Like, I would have to say, so for a long time, what's the film Gangs of New York?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I forgot about that.
I used to love that movie. I would have to say that is one of his worst.
I didn't like it when I first saw it, and everybody loved it. But that was
it's
years ago.
It's way too fucking, like, what is it? Harvey Weinstein produced that one. That's the only one Harvey Weinstein ever worked on. And it's the only one that Scorsese didn't have final cut.
So you're saying that made a huge difference?
It did.
Even though it's largely critically acclaimed.
I think, you know, I like it when Scorsese has... Oh, there's also Mean Streets, which was his first gangster film, which is fucking awesome.
Still haven't seen that.
Oh, I remember.
I'm
rented
so far
it.
Behind on movies, man. I swear, movies and music. I'll discover something that's really old, and I'll think I'll be the only one to discover it. And it turns out like this was famous 30 years ago.
We'll touch on music now. What was the first album? That you listened to? The first time you can remember taking a Walkman, because I had a Walkman, I had a tape player.
Walkman? Ooh, I was going to say the first album that I was aware of was definitely, if you were born in the 80s, then Michael Jackson, of course, Thriller. But the first CD, first tape was Tupac.
Thug Life.
It was Tupac. It was All Eyes on Me, for sure.
Thug Life.
95, 96.
Shit. I know which one mine was. I was riding a bike when I was listening to it. I thought it was fucking so cool.
What?
Cranberries.
Really?
Yeah.
I got into them really late. Like I was just saying, I got...
Zombie.
Didn't one of them just die recently?
Well, she died, yeah. I forgot what it was. I don't know if it was on a... But she had an issue that was on a plane... But I don't know if that's when she died. Something happened. I'm not sure.
I'm a jinx because I swear every time I get onto a band or a musician or an artist, like I'll just like name somebody, Usher or somebody. Mm-hmm. I swear, like a day or a month later, if they're not already dead, they die. Like when I really get into them, and that happened to it was a rock band recently where I was like, yeah, I'm gonna go see them play, and oh. Chris Cornell.
Oh, shit, yeah.
The last night, and if anybody's listening, we're recording in Michigan. The last night he performed in Detroit, I was supposed to be there. And I was so mad. I was like, you know what? I have to work. I didn't call off. And the next day, of course, he was dead.
Yeah.
But, I swear, I'm like the kiss of death. If I like you, you'll die.
I like the taste of music that I have now. I remember the first CD that I bought. A lot of the music I listened to back then was regrettable, I will say. Counting Crows.
Is that bad?
Not completely, but it was Mr. Jones. Mr. Jones and me. That was the first CD that I bought with money.
But you have a nostalgic... your life was different back then.
Well, I can also remember some of the other albums that I bought that are probably a little more like, oh, fuck, Aaron, come on. Limp Bizkit. let's see, Creed. That was another one.
That hurt.
Yep. Nickelback.
Uh-huh. I heard they used to be good.
My whole music... Okay, so I'm going to get...
But before you go on, which one do you regret? You just... stumbled onto an interesting side topic. Which album or artist that you purchased that you regret the most? Like, you know what I mean?
311.
What is that?
Gotta Come Original or something. I don't know what the fuck is it.
One hit wonder?
No, they're actually pretty big, but it was like a fucking weed thing. Mm-hmm. So it, you know, not even 311. I'd have to say Creed. I was listening to a lot of music my brother was listening to because I'm just like, I was I just wanted to listen to something.
Mm-hmm.
And he gave me like his old Megadeth CD, which I was so fucking stoked on. And then the band Wise Blood, which no one remembers. And I was obsessed with it. And then Godsmack was another one.
Yep.
But my whole perception on music changed when I was in high school. Because the group of people that I was hanging out with changed. I actually finally, like my junior year, got a good group of friends. Two different groups. Kids my own age in my junior class, and then kids that were in the sophomore class. Greg Kustars, who I have to thank for my love of Radiohead, Weezer,
Greg.
And Weezer before the Green Album. So like the Blue Album, Pinkerton. Well, then we also listened to like Interpol. We listened to like all this stuff he introduced me to, the band Travis. It changed. Blur was another one. It was all 90s alternative, but it was good alternative. And then I met two guys named Craig Argenti and Brian Klopp, which I haven't talked to Brian since high school, but he and I like started listening to The Strokes. The Strokes were the band that changed it for me. Is This It?
High school, right?
Yeah, this is high school. One of the greatest albums I had ever heard. I saw like the video for it, and I'm like, I want to dress like that. I want to be like that. I want to hang out with people like that. And so like that, I was just completely stoked on. I ended up getting like a fucking jean jacket and everything, and changed the way that I looked. But I loved it. I loved the way that the music sounded. And then I started getting into the Pixies and started getting into Pavement and all these other bands. And then, like, the Misfits and all this shit, man.
A lot of the artists you listened to, you siphoned off from your friends.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What about you? Because, like, when I met you, you were listening to Queens of the Stone Age and, like...
Yeah, well...
Nirvana was huge.
It was kind of like you. Like, I siphoned my interest from largely my brother. He got me into real hip-hop. He got me into Wu-Tang. He got me into Biggie Smalls. Mm-hmm. And then right at my senior year of high school, it was almost like going into space. Or let's imagine, you know, you're an astronaut, you land on the moon. And then Mission Control tells you, and this is kind of weird, so follow me. Control says, hey man, we got enough gas, you can go to any planet you want. And that's how I felt in high school. It was like, all right, I know a lot about Mobb Deep and all this hip-hop artists that I love. What else is out there? So I was like you. It was like, all right, what is MTV playing? And I will watch what MTV was playing, and it was a lot of rock and roll. It was Linkin Park. It was Limp Bizkit. So from there, I started listening to them. And then from there, they told me, the artists I was listening to, they were telling me what they were inspired by. And then I would go from Limp Bizkit and Linkin Park to, oh, you like Nirvana? Who the hell is Nirvana? Then I would go listen to Nirvana. Then I'm like, wow, I can see why they like them.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, they're better than the people that I'm liking. So I would go from that to Nirvana to Alice in Chains, Alice in Chains to Megadeth. And basically, I siphon off my interests as an adult from artists.
See, we're the same way. Is like, so with other friends too, like buddy Tom at the time introduced me to a hip-hop group called Jurassic 5. And I started listening to Jurassic 5, and then got into Black Star and Tribe Called Quest. Ooh, like all these different hip-hop groups, and I started picking and choosing what I wanted to hear. And now, like, looking at it, and as I've gotten older, listen to a lot of, like, I would say Nashville kind of mountain rock. Tyler Childers, I think is his name, is something that I listen to.
Is this country?
Yes and no. It's weird because, like, I listen to, I think it's Trampled by Turtles and stuff like this, but it's been going more to like an Appalachian sound. I wouldn't say it's completely country. I would say it's more, I'd like to, maybe it is country, I don't know, but like it's not what most people think country is, like Garth Brooks or like Brooks and Dunn or like Honky Tonk, Bad Donk, Bad Donk.
And there's nothing
bullshit
wrong with that kind of music. It sounds because, like, to me, you're still on a musical journey. as far as,
it is not stopped. Odetta sings Dylan. I found this album the other day when I was at a Salvation Army, and I was just like walking by, and I'm like, well,
do
I'm going to grab that.
Do you still do scavenger hunts at the Salvation
sometimes,
Army?
Sometimes. Yeah. Well, for records, if I find something. But this is a find. And it's scratchy pressing and everything like that. But I ended up downloading it on my phone because I'm like, I want to hear this, you know, the, you know, I guess digital way. But this is the song, one of the songs that I got. It's a cover of Dylan's With God on Our Side. And her voice is just fucking magical.
My age, it means less. Country I come from is called the Midwest. I was brought up and taught.
So that's like one of the, like, that's
that didn't even sound like, I didn't know what that was. It was, I mean that in a good way. I thought that was a man at first. And then it was like, no, it almost sounds like Cher if she would ever have gone that route.
It is a beautiful.
Oh, I loved it.
Black woman.
Get the fuck out of here. I was going to say, it sounded.
It's, well, see, the thing is that, like, I don't know what happened. I got on this gospel kick, like Reverend C.J. Thompson and Sister Rosetta Tharpe. And like, I just started digging and digging. And I love finding new music.
Me
like,
too.
And it's when it's like good. It's almost, so to go back into like the memory log, cinematic. I'm trying to remember the song that kind of did it for me cinematically. Like where it's like, this song should be my soundtrack. And I'm going to say that it is probably Shawshank Redemption. The whole soundtrack did it for me. And that's where it, like,
see,
I started
we're on the same page
because
I was going to say soundtrack. Yeah, I had a the Hook soundtrack, Steven Spielberg. Yep. That's what did it for me.
Yeah.
Jurassic Park.
Yeah, that was another one. Like anything Danny Elfman did, anything John Williams did. And there's Beasts of the Southern Wild.
What is that?
The soundtrack for that movie.
Oh,
It's a take on like a fairy tale in a sense. It's not like a true fairy tale. And the director writer just did another movie. I believe it's called, I want to say it's called Pan. I don't know. Wendy. It's called Wendy. It's like this magical type of like, it's hard to describe. It's like a dream. If you were having a dream of like being Peter Pan, these little kids, you know, in a sense being Peter Pan. And the soundtrack for that was amazing. It reminded me of, have you ever heard the band Sigur Rós? Or Cigaroos. No. That music. So for me, and movies have always been like kind of a religious thing for me, but I would have to say I'm leaning towards more music when it comes to being able to touch me in a certain way and not, you know, pulling my dick out of my pants and, you know, fucking doing that. Music don't do that for me. Only ladies do that for me.
I'm the opposite. I'm going to let you finish, but I think I'm the opposite the way I. Because of the visual aspect of it, like a mediocre song can be enhanced if the visuals are good. And that's how I've discovered music, like in other movies. If, for example, if I heard that music on its own on the radio, I might not have liked it, but because it hit at the right time in a movie that I like, then I'll be particular to that song or particular to that artist. But you're saying you lean more just to music bare bones.
Sometimes. Actually, you know what? I think you're a little more right than, because this, okay, so this song specifically, this is the last one I'll play, but the Sigur Rós song, I remember seeing it in Life Aquatic, and it wasn't on the soundtrack, and so I was wondering what it was, and I'm like, well, that's got to be Sigur Rós. And I cannot pronounce the song because it's Icelandic, and I'm not going to even fucking try. But it's the scene where he sees the jaguar, or the jaguar shark. He lost his best friend, and he's realizing, like, after chasing after all this, in a sense, it's nothing. It's meaningless. It's like, I miss my friend. That's what I've been trying to go after this entire time. And this song just fucking does the whole thing. Like, it's insane. So seeing that, it, you know, it, memory is a strange thing because I heard that song, I had seen that, and I'm like, I equated, you know, the song to it. What it brought up, and when I hear that song, it brings up different emotions, because it brings me back to certain things, pains in my life and celebrations, which in turn, with the Steve Zissou character, it's like he found the jaguar shark, but he misses his friend. When I hear that, I think of my son being born. I think of when, and I'll be completely honest, my fiance leaving me, you know, like that was another thing. Music, I love movies, and movies I equate more to memories with people that I love, going to see those films. But with music, it's more personal, I guess. Like, the movies are still personal, but like, it is very much more personal. I equate emotion to those songs that I hear. With movies, I can remember certain movies that I went to go see with certain people. Like, I remember seeing Eternal Sunshine with this friend of mine that I no longer talk to. We went to go see it, and I was like completely blown away. She didn't understand it, and I'm like, well,
that is Wes Anderson.
Yeah,
either you get it or you don't.
Eternal Sunshine was that one. So, you know, with the younger listeners, if there are any out there, a lot of these movies are how I saw them. Like, we had the blockbusters and whatnot, sure. But that was actually a little more expensive. What I did, I went to the library. I went to the library and rented a lot of these films, like all the Kurosawa films, Seven Samurai.
See, I wish I did that. I didn't do that. That was smart.
I would get CDs too, and I would download, like, Peter Yorn, like, shit like that. Oh, God, there was Pete Yorn, and then there was another one. Oh, Wilco. That's how I got, like, Wilco albums. I would just go there.
So wait a minute. So did you go to the library knowing what you wanted to get, or did you just like pick randomly?
Sometimes I would pick random. I will be honest with you. I did not go to the library for the books. I went there for the CDs and the movies. And there were certain movies where it's like, I really want to see this because, you know, like, it. Sometimes it was based off of the covers. But yeah, that's like some of my best memories were in libraries, just fucking, you know, going through albums and like trying to get as much as I could. And then,
do they exist anymore?
The libraries? Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Every you know, like,
that wasn't an insult. I don't know.
Every city, at least in Southeast Detroit, like, or the suburbs or surrounding, they all have libraries. You get further up north, they don't have them. That means you're all fucking stupid.
I'm just saying, do you have a library membership?
No, not anymore.
Exactly.
I buy my books like a good capitalist.
Sure. No. That's,
and I don't,
I'm not
read
saying
them.
Because I don't have a library membership that I don't read books, but I'm just thinking like,
oh, dude, I do audiobooks, man. Audiobooks. Yeah.
That's the way to go. I haven't done that yet. I want to.
I cannot retain shit when I'm reading. I'm like going
through.
Is that
better to hear it?
Yeah. Yeah. I'm able to retain it better. Like, well, like, movie wise, I'm able to retain that even better than listening to it.
Is it ever a movie that was based on a book that the movie was better?
Goodfellas was so much better than the book Wise Guys.
Godfather. That was based on a book. Was that better?
Never read it.
I read some of it. What about
Game of Thrones?
Yeah.
Too many dicks. On both ends.
That's true. We talking about memories. My shit was definitely Hook. That was the movie that I can always, and Home Alone. Home Alone 1.
Get into it, man.
Home Alone 1 and Hook is the movie where every time I watch, I'm a kid again. Every fucking time. But it reminds me of Christmas. Robin Williams, of course, is in Hook. And then, of course,
Macaulay Culkin.
Yeah. You can't beat that, man.
And I think that's where we differ is, like, I had, as much as, you know, like, I was in suburbs and whatnot, I had a tough childhood growing up where, like, I looked or leaned towards more adult things, where you still find, and that's what I love about you, you find the magic in things, where I look at it and it's like, you see sand and it's like, I can make a castle out of that. And then I see sand and I'm like, well, I can stick my dick in that.
Why so is that's that?
I don't know. We'll talk to you guys later. Thanks for listening to Ace. Hey guys, it's Aaron. You think you could do me a big fave? Wherever you're listening to this right now, rate and subscribe. Find new episodes every Wednesday where you listen to podcasts. And look for us on all the social media sites and Gmail at afterschoolspecialpodcasts at Gmail, afterschoolspecialpodcasts at Instagram and Facebook, and afterschoolspe3 on Twitter.
Talk some more because I have mental issues.